أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين ولعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين إلى أبد الأبدين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. When we come to study the life and the lives of those who were sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as prophets and as messengers for the guidance of mankind on the face of this earth, we see that all of these individuals, all of the prophets, all of the messengers and their successors, and all of those whom they left behind to continue the message, to continue the path that they had started, they were in the midst of the targets of the people, of the ignorant individuals who lived at that time. Those ignorant individuals, they targeted these prophets. They targeted all of those messengers. They targeted their families and their successors for one reason and one reason only. That they did not understand the sole purpose of the presence and the existence of those prophets and messengers. Merely many of them believed, many of those people, many of those ignorant individuals who lived at those times believed that these individuals, these prophets and these messengers, they were there to deprive them of their luxurious lives or to take away some of their benefits or some of the interests or some of their desires that they had. But a minute number of those people, they believed in those prophets, they believed in those successors, and they understood their message and their goal and what those individuals wanted to achieve, and that they wanted to guide mankind to the right path. Ever since history, from the existence of the first mankind on the face of this earth, being Prophet Adam and being his wife Hawa, Eve, those individuals, they wanted the best for the mankind. None of the prophets and none of the messengers and none of the successors and those who were positioned by God Almighty, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to guide mankind and to represent the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the face of this earth, had any desires or had any needs or wants and had an eye on the people's lives or wanted to take away any of their belongings or whatever they had of luxurious benefits around them. If we study the lives of those important, infallible, sincere and sacred prophets and messengers and successors, we see that the majority of those individuals, they chose to live life similar to the life of the poorest individual in those nations that they were sent to guide. They did not look for luxurious lives. They did not have any interests in the worldly desires around them. They had one goal and one aim only, and that was for the time and the time span of their prophethood and their responsibility that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had sent them on the face of this earth. They wanted to fulfill and accomplish their message and their duty and their responsibility in the best of ways, and for them to leave and depart this world having fulfilled what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given them as a responsibility. Let's go and read and research and investigate about the lives of all of those prophets from the beginning of time until time today and until the rise of the time. All of those successors, all of those who call people towards the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will see them living a life of troubles and pain and misery and death and being threatened from left, right and center. Why? Because at every time and in every stage of life, there are individuals who want to deprive those individuals, those prophets and those sincere individuals of their livelihood, of their habitat, of their good lives, which they themselves had invested in the good of the others, in the good of mankind. The Prophet of Islam, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him and his holy progeny, in the book Majma'ul Zawa'id. Majma'ul Zawa'id is one of the books the Muslims can go back to and relate to for understanding some of the riwayat and traditions that had been narrated by the Holy Prophet. In Majma' al-Zawa'id, chapter number 9, page 171, there is a narration narrated by the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him and his holy progeny, which says, "Inna Allah Azza wa Jal, Inna Lillahi Azza wa Jal hurumatun thalath." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, amongst the sacred and amongst the sanctities that he has placed for himself, there are three things. مَنْ حَفِظَهُنَّ حَفَظَ اللَّهُ لَهُ أَمْرَ دِينَهُ وَدُنْيَاهُ. Anyone that holds those three important things sacred and protects these sanctities, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will look after the religion, the deen and the dunya, which means this life and the hereafter will be protected. He will be looked after in this life and the hereafter by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who? That individual that protects the sacredness and the sanctity of these three important items. وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْفَظْهُنَّ لَمْ يَحْفَظْ لَهُ شَيْئًا. Whoever does not protect these important things, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not protect him, neither in this life nor in the hereafter. What are those things, brothers and sisters? Let's come and understand some of the problems and some of the troubles these sacred individuals had to go through for the sake that you and me are guided towards the right path, and how people treated them. And this is not only something mentioned in the books of the Shia and the followers of Ahlul Bayt. No. The narrations and the historical facts that I am going to mention have been narrated in the books of all the Muslims, and all the Muslims accept that these events did actually occur at the time of the Holy Prophet and after the demise and the martyrdom of the Holy Prophet of Islam. And that some of these historical events did actually befall upon the closest of individuals upon the Holy Prophet, his daughter, his grandchildren, and his cousin and successor Ali ibn Abi Talib, and some of the sincere companions of the Holy Prophet. So the first sacred thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to protect, and if we protect these things, Allah will protect us in this life and the hereafter, is Hurmatul Islam, the sacredness and the sanctity of Islam, the message of Islam, which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to protect the banner of Islam. What is the banner of Islam? What is the message of Islam? Is that all people should believe in oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is just, and to follow the footsteps of the Holy Prophet of Islam and Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam, which will eventually lead them to the hereafter, and to believe that there is a life after this, and that every individual on the face of this earth will stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they will be tested and they will be questioned about every single minute they lived on the face of this earth. Okay? Hurmatul Islam. The sacredness of Islam. The fact that the message of Islam is sacred. The holiness of the Holy Quran. The holiness of the Holy Prophet and his holy progeny. To protect the holy progeny of the Holy Prophet. To respect the Holy Prophet. To protect the name of the Holy Prophet. The second important sacred item is wa hurmati. The Holy Prophet says, first you have to protect the sacredness and the sanctity of Islam, the message that I came with, and for more than 21 years I gave everything in my power, in my existence, and everything that I owned for the sake of the propagation of this message. And the second important thing is wa hurmati. The Holy Prophet is sacred. The Holy Prophet has a sanctity that we have to protect. He is not a normal individual. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. You are the best individual carrying the best of morals and akhlaq. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. O Prophet of Islam, we have sent you to be a source of mercy for the whole world. So we have to protect the sacredness of this individual in his life and after his life. And the third point, وَحُرْمَةُ رَحِمِي. The same way you protect my sanctity and you protect my sacredness, you have to protect the sacredness of my progeny and those who are linked to me by blood, my blood relatives. Rahimi, which means Fatima al-Zahra, the daughter of the Holy Prophet. Ali ibn Abi Talib, the cousin of the Holy Prophet, and the successor appointed by the Holy Prophet to lead the Ummah, the nation, straight after him. Hassan al-Hussein, the grandchildren, whom on many occasions Rasulullah spoke about the greatness of those individuals and the position of those two holy individuals. Al-Hassan wal-Hussein, Sayyida Shababi Ahl al-Jannah. Hassan al-Hussein are the masters of the youth of the paradise. Al-Hassan wal-Hussein Rayhanataya min al-Dunya. Hassan al-Hussein are part of me from this life. Al-Hassan wal-Hussein imamani qama au qa'ata. On many occasions Rasulullah spoke and explained to the Muslims the position of the family. Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. In the Holy Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has many verses showing us the position of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. In Surah Al-Ahzab, verse number 33, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهِ لِيُذْهِبَ عَنْكُمُ الرِّجْسَ أَهْلِ الْبَيْتِ وَيُطَحِّرَكُمْ تَطْهِيرًا. The very verse that Rasulullah, the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for six months every day, he used to come and stand before the door of the house of Fatima al-Zahra salamullahi alayha and hold on to the handle of the door and repeat this verse and raise his voice so the whole of the Muslims can hear the statement of the Holy Prophet. And he used to repeat this verse, إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهِ لِيُذْهِبَ عَنْكُمُ الرِّجْسَ أَهْلَ الْبَيْتِ. O people of the house, O household, the one that you live in this house. Who used to live in that house? Ali, Fatima, Hassan and Hussein. إِنَّمَا Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهِ, Allah wants, لِيُذِهِبَ عَنْكُمُ الرِّجْسَ أَهْلَ الْبَيْتِ وَيُطَحِّرَكُمْ تَطْهِيرًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has purified you, a thorough purification. 6 months. What did the Holy Prophet want to show? The sanctity and the sacredness of the family, of his progeny, of his blood relatives. Why? Because he was saying to the Muslims, O Muslims, if I was to leave and depart this life, make sure you treat them the same way you treat me in my lifetime. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has three sacred sanctities. من حفظهن حفظه الله حفظ الله له أمر دينه ودنياه. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will save and protect the issues and the matters of his deen, his religion, and his dunya, his life in this world. ومن لم يحفظ, and whomever does not protect and look after those three sacred sanctities that Allah wants us to protect, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْفَظَهُنَّ لَمْ يَحْفَظَهُ لَمْ يَحْفَظَ لَهُ شَيْئًا. Allah will never protect and guide the one that does not protect the sanctity and sacredness of these three items. حُرْمَةُ الْإِسْلَامِ وَحُرْمَةِ رسول الله سبحانه وتعالى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم وحرمة رحمه. These three things. We will come to understand in the duration of this program how those individuals who claimed to be followers of the Holy Prophet, who claim to be followers of the message of Islam, they claim to be those who are amongst those who are protecting the sanctity and the sacredness of Islam, Hurmatul Islam. They claimed in their parents, in front of everyone, they were individuals who protected the sanctity of Islam, Hurmatul Islam. They pretended to love the Holy Prophet. They pretended to love Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. So they had in front of people the three important protections against those three sacred sanctities. But deep inside, what did they believe? In Surah Al-Imran, in verse 144, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed this verse, which is a message to all mankind. What is that verse? The verse says, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلُ. اللهم صلى على محمد. أَفَإِنْ مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلَ انقلبتم عَلَى عَقَابِكُمْ وَمَنْ يَنْقَلِبْ عَلَى عَقِبَيْهِ فَلَنْ يَضُرَّ اللَّهَ شَيْئًا. Muhammad is no more than a messenger. Many were the messengers before him that had passed away. وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلُ. Muhammad, peace be upon him and his holy progeny, is merely a prophet and a messenger, of which there were many prophets before him who had passed away. The point is here, أَفَإِنْ مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلْ. Why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention these two phrases if they were not going to happen to the Holy Prophet? If he dies or was slain, if the Holy Prophet of Islam was going to die a normal natural death, why would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala include a description of a particular way that a person would pass away and leave and depart this life? Being slain, being killed, being assassinated. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Imran, chapter 144, he comes and says, if he, the Holy Prophet, was to die, which everyone dies, everyone will die, everyone will leave and depart this life. But the next phrase is very important. If he was to die, or was slain, or was assassinated, was killed, became a martyr, Will you turn back on your heels? If the Holy Prophet of Islam was assassinated, there will be a group of you that will turn back to the original practices that they used to believe in. أَفَإِنْ مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلْ إِنْ قَلَبْتُمْ. You will turn against the message of Islam and the message of the Holy Prophet. أَفَإِنْ مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلْ إِنْ قَلَبْتُمْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِكُمْ وَمَنْ يَنْقَلِبْ عَلَىٰ عَقِبَيْهِ فَلَنْ يَضُرَّ اللَّهَ شَيْئًا. And if you were to turn back on your heels, you will least harm Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not lose out. But you, the ones will be losers, the ones that you turn against the Holy Prophet of Islam. Let's come and read and recite and understand some of the traditions from the Holy Prophet of Islam and his family. This tradition, and inshallah, we will continue in the coming episodes. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam says, إِنَّ لِكُلِّ نَبِيٍّ حَرَمًا وَحَرَمِيَ الْمَدِينَةِ اللَّهُمَّ إِنِّي أُحَرِّمُهُمَا بحرمتك لا يوافيها محدث ولا يختلي خلها ولا تؤخذ لقطتها إلا لمن شد. And this is a tradition mentioned in Kenz al-Ummal, the book number 12, page number 242, and the hadith is Hadith number 34,864, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam comes and says that every prophet, every messenger has a sacred haram, a sacred place allocated to him. Wa harami al-Madinah, and my sacred city and my sacred location is the city of Medina. Allahumma, the Holy Prophet prays and asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allahumma inni uharrimuha bihurmatik, which means that, O Allah, I, your messenger, have made this city a sacred city, which means that anyone that will come after me, after my demise and after my life, and who will try to take away the sacredness or to step on the sanctity of the sacredness of my city and my sacredness and the sacredness of my family and progeny who live in the city of Medina, O Allah, I ask you to bring down your wrath and adab upon them. And with this hadith and with this tradition, we shall end this session, and inshallah in the next session we will come to discuss further of some of the historical events that befell on the Holy Prophet and his holy progeny after the martyrdom of Rasulullah, peace be upon him and his holy progeny. Hada wa assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.